Las Vegas is always new, its drawing board regularly scraped clean. As fresh mirages rise from the desert floor, old ones are wiped away.
I was born here in Las Vegas, February the 25th, 1920. I'm 80 years old. And Las Vegas has not been good to preserve the history of Las Vegas. They don't seem to care about it. Everything is the gambling. The gambling didn't start Las Vegas. The railroad did. And so our history's gone down the drain.
Neglected, history becomes rumor.
Things that we've long considered facts ain't facts. Just to pick the most obvious example, everybody knows that the mob built Las Vegas, and that the mob in Las Vegas was Benjamin Bugsy Siegel. He created the Flamingo, and the movies are about it, and the books are about it. Turns out he probably didn't, because there's hard evidence now that somebody else had that original dream.
Lies are sometimes preserved as history, but history is mainly disfigured with holes. The marks of memory are partial, and between the footprints of the past are empty spaces. Nature preserves tracks and fossils. Humans embalm the dead, save records and artifacts. When a natural or human record is lost, or a person with a head full of memories dies, part of the past disappears. Clark County Museum preserves the bones, stones, tools, engines, clothes, and bows and arrows, all the artifacts of the people of the American Southwest, so we can know what happened here and who made the past into the present. While the museum keeps our stories, the museum has a story of its own. As the present dies, history begins. So the story of Clark County Museum begins with the death of Anna Roberts Parks.
My grandmother died in April in 1962.
Anna Parks was riding on Fremont Street with her husband Gene when a car smashed into the side of their Jeep.
And she hit the windshield, then she was thrown back into her seat, and then she went out the door, and she was thrown across the intersection, and she hit the curb.
Anna Roberts Parks was as tough as sagebrush, self-invented, an unexpected woman. She made a memorable impact on Las Vegas, but she hasn't been remembered. She made local history, but she can't be found in history books. She also preserved history. What she saved was the seed for the county museum.
She worked all the time. I don't think she ever, I can't remember her ever sitting still. She was always on the go.
Like many early Southern Nevadans, Anna left tracks that can still be seen today. For instance, she homesteaded 160 acres of sand dunes between today's Flamingo Road and Harmon Avenue. In 1931, her crew had drilled an artesian well when two men approached. They were surveyors aiming Sandhill Road straight toward Anna's new well. She met them with a rifle. The men looked at her rifle, then into Anna's eyes. They decided the road should detour.
When you look at Sandhill Road and you see the curve, she was saving her well.
Just blocks from the Fremont Street collision which killed Anna sat her Parks Museum, the collection she spent her life assembling.
I had seen it in 1950 or so. It was just this little eccentric lady that came to the door, and she invited us in to browse, and I don't believe she even charged us anything for it. I'm pretty sure she didn't. But the thing impressed me the most was that she had collected everything. It was tremendous, and I loved it. I considered her at the time to be eccentric, but the older I get, the more eccentric I am. So she was just probably being herself.
Before Anna came to this valley, others had lived here for millennia. Anna quickly saw the importance of these first peoples. She came to know some of the Paiutes well. She discovered everything she could about how they and other Native Americans survived in this brittle land. She collected artifacts for decades.
She was ready to go. I mean, my dad came back from a deer hunting trip one time, and he said, "Anna, I've got something for you, and I'm gonna see you tomorrow. I'm gonna give it to you, you know." Well, she couldn't wait. He finally had made, she made him dig it out, you know. He'd found a skinning tool the Indian used to skin deer. And he showed that, he gave it to her. And she said, do you remember where this spot is? And he said, yeah. And she said, well, we're leaving in the morning. And we're going to go back there and you're going to show me where this is. So well, they were off.
In 51 years of collecting, she filled her building with many tons of artifacts. But when Anna died, her museum was shuttered.
The collection, we kind of just kind of locked it up and left everything like it was. For the longest time, it seemed like.
Anna's daughter, Edith Jennings, knew her mother had collected the history of Southern Nevada for those who live here. Edith offered to give the collection to the city of Las Vegas if the city would create a museum, but officials said the city couldn't afford one. She offered Clark County the collection, land for a museum, and $5,000 toward a building fund. The response was the same. She tried Tiny Nevada Southern University. She approached the state of Nevada. She asked the LDS Church. She spoke to a number of casino owners. Years were passing. Then a Western hotel chain offered to buy the collection and move it out of state.
Harvey House wanted it. They would offer her $250,000. And her stepfather, Gene Parks, wanted to take it. She said, no, mother said these things are going to stay in Nevada. And I'm going to see that her wishes are carried out.
Edith needed serious resolve to turn down $250,000. She settled down to keep patiently seeking support. In 1966, Mary Ellen Sadovich noticed Edith at the meetings of the Southern Nevada Historical Society.
She didn't say very much. And then one time, the membership was talking about the possibility of having a museum in Las Vegas. And Mrs. Jennings stood up and said, I have a great big collection of historical material, museum material, and I would be glad to give it to the Historical Society if they will do something with it. Carol Knutson, I believe, was the president. And he said, Mrs. Jennings, we have spoken of this before, and you know that the city would love to have this, but they can't possibly pay the expense of building a museum, and then after that, maintaining it and maintaining personnel to direct it. I thought that was a little bit odd. I couldn't believe what she had in that warehouse. There was elegant chinaware, beautiful glassware, old pianos from that looked like they had been in bars and casinos and things, and player pianos, and organs, and these very old-fashioned gambling machines. Many of the things were old-time furniture and things from the mining camps.
Mary Ellen asked Edith whether she had tried the city of Henderson.
And she said, I would love to give it to anyone who will build a museum.
Mary Ellen took Edith's offer to Ellen Frainer, executive secretary of the Henderson Chamber of Commerce. Henderson felt like the unloved stepchild of Southern Nevada, and the chamber thought a museum might help the city's image. The board appointed a committee. 1966 ended, 1967 passed. At the start of 1968, the board approved the project, but no immediate action was planned. By this time, Glenn Taylor, manager of Basic Magnesium, was in charge and had his eye on the old Henderson Townsite School, which was being replaced.
And then in January of 68, right after New Year's, there was vandalism took place at the site on 21st Street. And a lot of the stuff was damaged and lost. They stomped on baskets and broke chandeliers.
Just brutalized her place, and a lot of the arrowheads were spilled out on the floor. And lots of them were lost. Some of the spear points, the better things were taken.
Junior high school kids had gotten in there and done the damage. They found them selling arrowheads at the school.
By mid-January, most of what remained of the park's collection was safely in the Henderson Townsite School gym. Family members kept items to which they felt attached. The rest of the artifacts were brought to Henderson. A nonprofit organization was created, and on March 19, 1968, Anna's family officially donated her collection to the new Southern Nevada Museum. People began to wonder who Anna Roberts Parks was, and a little of her story emerged. She was born Mary Anna Newfer on July 2, 1888, in a farmhouse between Venus and Oil City in Pennsylvania, the seventh of 11 children. Anna's late daughter Edith wrote down her memories of her mother. She would tell me of the woods and berries they picked and how much she liked school. She was in bed for 1 year with knee injuries from her knees caught under her sled. She wasn't supposed to walk again, and I can still hear her high heels running up and down the stairs. She told me stories of tornadoes and how they would all go to the cellar, and once lightning nearly killed them. She pitched hay, milked cows, did it all.
She must have been responsible. And she told me once, when I was a little girl, that one summer she worked for her dad, those 3 months. She worked very hard, and she said at the end of that summer he handed her a dime. Well, even then a dime wasn't very much. You know, I made some comment, "Oh, Grammy, I can't believe that." And she said, "That was a lot of money, and I was really proud that he gave me that."
In 1911, Anna stepped off a train at a little stop called Las Vegas. 6 years earlier, the San Pedro, Los Angeles, and Salt Lake Railroad Company had auctioned land surrounding today's Fremont Street to create the community of Las Vegas as a railroad support site with repair shops and a plant to make ice for trains. By 1910, the new Las Vegas and Tonopah Railroad connected Las Vegas to the gold mining districts of Rhyolite, Beatty, and Goldfield, and the town began to boom. When she arrived in dusty Las Vegas, Anna was 22 and single. She was escorted by twice-widowed 55-year-old William Roberts. The couple met in Bakersfield, where Will was an oil field supervisor, and Anna worked as a cook in a boarding house. Anna said he rode up in his buggy and swept her away. He had great energy, ambitious plans, and much charm. As Will looked out over the prospect from their Las Vegas hotel, he saw business potential. The couple established residences, and Anna's 18-year-old sister Teresa arrived from Pennsylvania, probably as Anna's chaperone. Will and Anna opened a dry goods store downtown in the spring of 1912. The People's Store offered millinery, thread, dresses, hats, and toys. Its first location is lost to us, but in January 1913, they moved the store to the Levy Building on the north side of Fremont Street. In 1912, Paiutes were a notable presence in the small town, and some of them were customers of the People's Store. Anna traded with them, her wares for Native American baskets and tools, which she collected for the next 50 years. Six years after she began, on April 20, 1968, her collection opened on Water Street in Henderson as the first public museum in the Las Vegas Valley. Her private Parks Museum had become the nonprofit Southern Nevada Museum.
And you paid your money and then you kind of walked around the room and they had tables and things set up. It was really primitive.
Local collectors loaned historic objects to fill out the Parks collection, then began donating artifacts and documents. Individuals who had held on to the past finally had a repository that would conserve and exhibit what they had saved. Southern Nevada Museum became a collections magnet.
We have a really wonderful collection of local Southern Paiute baskets that were collected around the early 1900s by a man named Owen Poth. It's probably one of the best examples of Southern Paiute basketry anywhere.
Paiutes made these baskets to sell to whites.
We even have two teacup and saucer baskets, a sugar bowl basket. Some of them have some very interesting designs. One has a louse as a design element on it. Some have projectile points, quail top knots.
Collector Astrid Ekman donated many items, including one particular Mojave ceramic.
a Native American Mojave effigy jar, a very special piece of pottery from a group of Native Americans that are no longer even represented in that media. This effigy jar, complete with its own beaded necklace and earrings, just an incredible collector's piece. That effigy jar now stands as a primary part of our continuous exhibit on the Colorado Indian tribes.
No Nevada museum can ignore mining. Nevada was admitted to the Union because its gold and silver mining industry was important to the Civil War. Men from the Mormon Fort, the first European settlement at Las Vegas, mined lead on Mount Potosi. Mining is especially well represented in Anna Roberts Park's collection. Her role in the development of mining around Las Vegas was almost forgotten, but it was crucial. When Will Roberts and Anna Neufer arrived in 1911, they had plans beyond the people's store. Will knew limestone was needed to process ore in Goldfield and to refine sugar in Southern California. Limestone deposits were known to exist around Las Vegas, and in the summer of 1912, high-quality limestone was discovered near Sloan, 16 miles to the south. With several partners, including William Elwell, whose son later built the Elwell Hotel on Bridger Street, and Anna's sister Teresa, Will and Anna created Nevada Lime and Plaster Company. In August 1913, the Las Vegas Age reported the new business was on the road to success, with 15 men already employed. But the company needed a major infusion of cash. 24-year-old Anna Neufer set out to find investors and searched all the way back to Pennsylvania. Incredibly, she raised $64,000, 90% of the company's capital. She became corporation secretary. Hers was the official signature on the company's land deeds and contracts. In 1945, the highest quality limestone in Sloan began to run out, and the company added a second quarry at Apex, where it mines lime and dolomite today as the Chemical Lime Company. The original site in Sloan has been quarried ceaselessly for 90 years. Now each year, Frainer Construction removes 1 million tons of high-quality aggregate from the quarry. That stone strengthens the concrete walls of the major strip hotels and the foundations and asphalt of McCarran Airport's runways. In June of 1914, with their store and quarry humming, 59-year-old William Roberts and his 25-year-old business partner, Anna Neufer, caught a train to Los Angeles, where, after 3 years together in Las Vegas, they were married. Anna gradually complemented her Native American collection with a vast collection of rocks, minerals, and mining equipment. At the opening of Henderson's Southern Nevada Museum, mining and minerals held a central position. Anna's tons of rock and mineral samples created a space problem for the museum that has only worsened since. Just as Anna's Native American collection attracted other artifacts and whole collections, so her mining collection alerted owners of mining artifacts that a repository finally existed for their pieces. The mining section grew huge.
Besides the Anna Roberts Parks mineral collection, we have the Ivanelli mineral collection. Mrs. Ivanelli collected rocks and minerals all her life, and her house happened to be in the way of the new freeway going in, 93-95, the 515. It was like we had a semi full of rocks and minerals, but it's a wonderful collection.
We acquired a fabulous collection of mining stock certificates from the state of Nevada. Another thing that we acquired, which was very important, was a collection of mining engineering journals from the turn of the century. I think there were about 1,200 different magazines from between 1905 and 1930. You know, most people throw that kind of thing away.
Several years ago, a collection of mining equipment came to the museum, the Crumb Collection. Out on the museum property, we have various and sundry large pieces of equipment. We have a Holt Caterpillar tractor and two ore wagons that came from Sandy Valley. Now our large trucks, the dump truck, the mat crane, the compressor, those are all from the Red Cloud Mine in Good Springs. And that's gold, silver, lead mining that's over there. Our little flatbed truck was part of the Anna Roberts Parks collection. The water trailer was part of the Anna Roberts Parks collection.
Over the years, Anna pursued minerals with many rock hounding partners. She hunted rocks in the desert with other Las Vegas pioneers, such as banker John S. Park. In 1948, when rock hounds organized as the Clark County Gem Collectors, Anna was a charter member. She wanted a place where the club could meet and bought a barracks from what was then called Las Vegas Air Force Base.
That came in three parts, I think, and they hauled it out there and then they bolted it together, and she had her museum.
And meeting place. In 1948 or 49, when she set up the building, its 21st Street and Fremont location was isolated in the desert. Lou Bartlett was a gem collector in the early 50s and remembers Anna.
Very energetic little old white-headed lady at that time. And always on the move, very active, ready to go. If you mentioned a rock, where is it? What is it? Let's go. She was always ambitious to get going. It was quite surprising to me to see someone that old, so ambitious to collect all these rocks.
The limestone of Clark County is the combined deposit of billions of marine creatures who lived in Nevada when it was a sea. Other fossils illustrate the period between 10 and 12,000 years ago, when many large animals which had lived here for millions of years disappeared. When Henderson's Southern Nevada Museum hired the first curator to coax a story from its artifacts, he began with geology. 34-year-old Roy Purcell was a painter from Utah who created the displays for the Mojave Museum of History and Art in Kingman, Arizona. The Southern Nevada Museum brought him to Henderson.
Then they said, we have the collection, we have the condemned building, and we have no money. And what can you do? But as far as putting the exhibits together, it didn't take a lot of money. I used a lot of sand, a lot of rocks, a lot of brush, old canvas, you know, whatever I could find. I even found a carcass for the Spanish Trail exhibit. I went out in the muddy river and I found this dried up carcass of a horse. And since there were so many dead animals on the trail in the history, you know, that's been left, I dragged it in, stunk a little bit, but it added flavor to the exhibit.
Roy created a large circular display, painting large backdrops for the various chapters of Southern Nevada's story, beginning with geology. Roy displayed the eras of Native Americans, the Spanish Trail, Mormon pioneers, ranching, early Las Vegas, mining, and the construction of Hoover Dam. Objects from the Anna Roberts Parks collection illustrated each period. From its first day, Southern Nevada Museum struggled. Marge Ivory managed the museum before Roy was hired and remained as one of his assistants, the other being Mary Hubel.
In 74, they ran so short of funds that they said, well, we're going to have to, in October, they said, we're going to have to shut it down until after the first of the year because there's no money. And Marge felt that if it ever shut down, it wouldn't open again. And so she stayed on without any compensation for those 3 months and kept it open, she and Mary Hubel both.
As the struggle continued, Roy approached his fourth anniversary as director. Then the museum's long-range expansion plan, based on a generous land donation from the city of Henderson, came to a crisis.
We had 27 acres or something like that out here on Boulder Highway, and I didn't know that there was a time restraint on that. If we didn't use it, it didn't have something on the property within X number of years, then we'd lose the property back to the city. I didn't know that. And then I was told one day, we only have until, you know, 6 months or something like that. And I said, what? And then we lose it. Fortuitously, the railroad had just put an ad in the paper that they wanted to get rid of the depot in Boulder City.
The Southern Pacific Railroad donated the building. Volunteers and movers were organized, and the depot was moved to the Boulder Highway property, assuring the site for the museum.
That's about the time I left.
In In 1975, the Southern Nevada Museum Guild was formed to support the museum. It continues as an important arm today. The volunteer group started a series of vintage fashion shows to raise funds in the museum's profile and held old-fashioned holiday celebrations in the depot. The depot was a key acquisition, reflecting the railroad origins of Las Vegas and Clark County. A few years later, a locomotive the Junior League of Las Vegas had obtained from the Union Pacific was moved to the museum site. The museum equipped the depot with stacks of vintage luggage, an office, and a telegraph key that receives mysterious messages.
We approached the Union Pacific for a couple of cars that would look appropriate with the depot. And they were able to locate us a 1920s boxcar and a 1940s caboose. I shipped them down here. They were renovated and painted. And visitors are able to go in the caboose.
More recently, modern passenger cars were added on the other side of the station. Marjorie Walter's father was a railroad engineer and a photographer. She donated the photos he took starting in 1912.
Of course, he took pictures of different trains. He was proud of the trains. It was something. And there's a lot of old wrecks.
Well, the first project my wife and I co-sponsored with the museum was a program known as Railroad and Transportation Days. We had a live steam locomotive brought in and ran out here. We had helicopters from the Army bases. We had camels because they were very much a part of transportation here at one time in Nevada. And we had stagecoach rides. We had horse and carriages out here. And if it was transportation, one type or another, we tried to get it in. The passenger car that you see out here, that just most recently came in, had a lot of work to be done on that. We had to get equipment from a local supplier out here to jack it up, get the springs under it. That car itself is ready at this time to become a classroom. And for some of the groups that come out here, some of the school children that come out.
Railroad and Transportation Days have been held twice so far. Recently, Guy LaCrum, who donated mining equipment, added to the transportation collection.
She called us back and said that she had a Surrey that she would like to give us. And basically all we needed to do was come and get it. And we went over to her home, and here was this absolutely gorgeous, fully restored Surrey. And we just rolled it up on a flatbed and brought it out here. We would like to, in our new expansion, have a whole exhibit on the history of transportation, which that would be included in.
With the Boulder City Depot in place, an opportunity arose to represent the architecture of Nevada's early mining period, thanks to legendary local character Robert Caudle, generally known as Dobie Doc.
Dobie Doc, he was an endless, tireless promoter of Southern Nevada, and his contributions often were viewed at the Last Frontier Hotel, a famous hotel casino in the 1950s here, and he went for the Western theme in a big way. Old pictures of him in his overalls and with his Western hat on. The man lived the period, and he felt that it was proper to be transplanted in a major property like the Last Frontier Hotel and Casino. He went all over the state collecting historic buildings, and often, I think, with an abandon that probably scared the people of Northern Nevada, that would see a fellow with his truck and flatbed appear, and the next time he was gone, and so was one of their buildings. They formed the nucleus of what we referred to as a arrested decay area, where the buildings are maintained, but they're not improved. And to that end, there is a jail from Tuscarora, I believe, a general store from Pioche, a miner's cabin from Lamoille.
Anna Roberts Parks knew the boomtowns represented by Dobie Doc's rickety buildings. The third early Las Vegas business she and Will started drew her into the most emotional trials of miners and their families. Las Vegas Undertaker left town in 1915. Will Roberts had worked 10 years in a California mortuary. So in September, he opened Las Vegas Undertaking Company. Anna went along on undertaking trips and began to learn embalming. The mortician for Las Vegas handled deaths in the mining camps of Searchlight, El Dorado Canyon and Good Springs, and sometimes even Tonopah and Goldfield. Anna and Will apparently traveled in a horse-drawn wagon at first, then an early model automobile to the places miners died.
In these little towns, maybe they had lived in a little cabin in El Dorado Canyon or these outlying places. And they might have died 2 days before. But somehow this was not offensive to her. When these old prospectors would die or be found in the desert or something, they would always bring them to her, and she would do whatever she had to do. And many times there was no payment for these things.
Sometimes Anna was paid in mining tools or other relics that went into her collection. In 1917, the Las Vegas and Tonopah Railroad failed and the local boom busted. The Roberts split their time the next 3 years between Las Vegas and Fresno County, California, where their only child, Edith, was born in 1920. In 1921, Will returned full-time to run Las Vegas Undertaking, but Anna took her mother and daughter to Los Angeles. Though well-experienced, she wanted her embalming license. She entered mortician school as the only woman student, despite Will's opposition. Mr. Roberts, as she called him, had done it all and was very well-to-do and only wanted her to enjoy life with him. But Anna got a taste of making money, and that was that. She wanted to work, work, work. No more breakfast in bed and an old man's darling. Anna passed her embalming exam in April 1925. Then she learned that in the apartment over what was now called Roberts Undertaking, Will was living with a married woman named Ethel Nace. The crisis energized Anna. She visited the apartment while Will and Ethel were out and snatched every financial record she could find. Then she hired an attorney and filed for divorce. Will denied everything. A July newspaper story hinted at fireworks in the courtroom when it noted pleasantries exchanged between the Roberts. While the divorce dragged on, Nevada Lime and Rock was purchased by Los Angeles businessman Jess Knight. In June 1926, after a year of maneuvering, attorneys hammered out a divorce settlement. Will was awarded Roberts Undertaking. Anna won custody of Edith and two lots on Fremont Street. Neither Anna nor Will could have imagined the gambling palace that would tower above those lots in the 1950s. Binion's Horseshoe Club grew into a neon hallucination. By 1979, Fremont Street became an alien landscape. On March 1st, 1979, Beckley House, a rare surviving home of early Las Vegas, the residence of the owners of Beckley's men's store, was lifted from its foundation at 420 South 4th Street and trundled down the Neon Canyon. The Junior League had raised money for years and finally managed to save the endangered structure. Southern Nevada Museum gave it sanctuary. As the old house rolled across the valley, the museum changed hands. The staff, including the second director, Bernard Buzz Nolan, had moved the collections from the townsite school gym into the depot in April 1978. Though Clark County originally declined Anna Park's collection, it supported Southern Nevada Museum from the start, and some officials watched it with growing interest. The county commission asked Buzz to evaluate the operation and must have liked his report. The day Beckley House moved, the county formally adopted the museum, eventually renaming it the Clark County Heritage Museum and recently shortening that to Clark County Museum. Beckley House anchored Heritage Street, now a full block of historic buildings rescued from destruction in Las Vegas, Henderson, and Boulder City. The second Heritage Street building was a print shop funded by the Donald W. Reynolds Foundation, built to look old and house 1880s printing equipment donated by Henderson Home News publisher Maury Zenoff. Then came Henderson Townsite House, a composite of 8 houses, taking features from each to recreate an original company house before upgrades or additions. Boulder City House followed, one of those erected by Babcock and Wilcox for the company's Hoover Dam workers. From 7th Street in Las Vegas came the P.J. Gaumond House, the home of the man who created the Boulder Club, one of the earliest Fremont Street casinos. Gaumond also developed Tule Springs as an early ranch resort. The Giles Barkas House was built in Goldfield and had a second life in Las Vegas as an antique shop.
The last member on Heritage Street is a lowly little motor court cottage, cottage number 14, from some nameless motel that we don't know. It was one of the motor courts that had a central facility that had your showers, sinks, and toilets. And then the little cottages basically had just the bed, a table, and maybe either a sink or a pitcher and bowl in them. You have to open the windows if you want to get cool.
Heritage Street came just in time for Southern Nevada.
Over the 80s and 90s, there were a number of structures that had been designated as historic structures that were neglected, abandoned, mistreated, and then eventually lost. The ice plant, for example, the key building in early, one of the key buildings in early Las Vegas, was closed up, abandoned, vagrants sort of got in, fires were set. The Las Vegas Hospital, which was on the National Register of Historic Places as well, same kind of situation. It ceases to serve its original function and is boarded up and becomes surplus property. A fire starts and the building is lost. Las Vegas has lost virtually all of its early history, that is, early history as a railroad town. What is lost is that sense of where Las Vegas came from, that you know, we grew into this fabulous resort city, but we grew from this tiny nugget of a railroad town.
With landmark structures obliterated, the houses of Heritage Street take on more importance.
The County Museum has done a fabulous job in selecting buildings that represent really key turning points and renovating them in sympathetic ways. Boulder City Townsite House. You can get some idea of what it was to live in this area in the 1930s when the dam was being built, or the modest circumstances of the Henderson Townsite House. And what a temporary community Henderson was supposed to be, and now it's the second largest city in the state. Architecturally, some of the houses that are preserved there say something about Las Vegas and about Las Vegas's role in connection to other areas. The Beckley House, which is the California bungalow style, well, that's when Las Vegas was growing up, when the bungalow style was there. And right next door, the steep roofs and half timbering of the Gaumond House. So I think those houses say something about the town, about the style of the town, and you know, I think that's a very valuable function.
Each is furnished to represent a particular period, and parts of Anna's and the many other collections can be seen throughout. The Museum Guild helped furnish the houses, beginning with the Henderson Townsite House in the style of the 40s.
Some of my wedding gifts, which of course I received in 1940, were just exactly what we needed. So that's when I started out bringing things out.
And that way you're not just showing a glass case with a dozen flat irons in it. Rather, you're showing that flat iron on its ironing board with a human scale mannequin doing a type of ironing that perhaps required that iron to be heated over a fire. So the houses have been one of our space spreaders that have allowed us to compensate for the real lack of exhibit space this museum has had to date.
In the early West, old buildings were often relocated. The Cottage Hotel, a boarding house at first in Carson, came to Las Vegas from the failing boomtown of Rhyolite. In October 1926, the hotel was damaged in a fire. Anna Roberts wanted it. After her divorce, with her mother and daughter to support, Anna turned to the Elwell family. Bill Elwell had helped found Nevada Lime and Plaster and joined Will in many business ventures. Now, Anna took a job at Elwell Furniture. With her mortician's license in her pocket, she wanted to open her own mortuary, but friends cautioned her. Myrtle Ferris, a California mortician's wife, opened a letter to Anna by summing up local conditions from the special point of view of the undertaker. "We are all well despite the fact that there is lots of sickness around, but not many deaths." Will and Robert's undertaking were her main concern. If the other side can hold the house, it is pretty easy against a woman. Is the death rate there enough for two undertakers? And if you start, can Mr. Roberts or some of his friends get his building and work against you? You know far better than I how hard it is for a woman to buck this business. But Anna had many friends in Las Vegas, and the divorce turned opinion against Will. He returned to California to build a successful mortuary chain. Anna tried to buy the cottage hotel, but negotiations were difficult. She only managed the purchase by traveling to see the owner in Los Angeles. While there, Anna bought a little palm tree. She brought it back and planted it in front of her new building. On May 16, 1927, she opened her one-woman business as Palm Funeral Home. Today, Palm Mortuaries, which Anna sold in 1946, is dominant in Southern Nevada with six locations. But in 1927, another new company had just opened, and it was hard to know whether her business would survive. She had her business, funerals, and worked as Mr. Elwell's bookkeeper at his second-hand store a half a block away, and if she got a call, she would go and take care of her business and go back to Elwell's. She would babysit all their kids at night with me along.
She was a pretty aggressive person. She could do anything to make a buck, you know. In those days, times were tough, and she didn't have much money, but by golly, she was out working to make a living.
9 months after Anna opened Palm Funeral Home, a Vontobel lumber employee named Gene Parks was granted a divorce. Anna hired Gene in his off hours to help around the mortuary. He didn't drink or smoke and could keep books. Anna thought he would be right for her business. He was polite and clean and neat, and she must have cared for him. Anna and Gene were married at the end of 1928.
She was a businesswoman. Even after she was married to Gene Parks, she probably ran her business because it was her business, and she was that type of a woman.
It was always my impression that she didn't really need Gene. But he did take care of the business part. He kept the books. I guess after she married him, she got rid of that part of it.
Anna saw Las Vegas change. Prostitution, liquor, and gambling were part of Las Vegas from the beginning. Then, 2 years before Prohibition even ended, Nevada legalized gambling. Legal gambling created a new Nevada, which is well represented in the county museum.
We have a large collection of slot machines dating from 1898 forward, and most of them are in working condition. It would be nice to have an area large enough to show them. We have craps tables, roulette wheels of fortune, faro tables. When the museum expansion happens, and I'm optimistic it will, we want to have one entire room devoted to the history of gaming and entertainment, because that's what people like to see. We have uniforms from practically every hotel, from kino runners, cocktail waitresses, security guards. We also have showgirl outfits. We actually have a couple of showgirl costumes from the Folies Bergère. When you can see these things up close, it's pretty interesting. You see all the wear and tear on them, and that's kind of the idea that we want to show, that, you know, this is somebody's uniform, even though it's a showgirl costume.
The woman who wore that costume was an everyday resident of Clark County. The museum preserves everyday life.
My wife donated some 1930 and 40 household utensils, such as irons, electric irons and stuff like that, 4 or 5 years ago. And I donated the 1959 Studebaker Lark. I hated to see the car possibly leave the area.
Life off the strip is the life of families and children. Many more children are growing up in Clark County in the new millennium than did in the 1920s when Anna's daughter Edith grew up on the second floor of Palm Mortuary. One of Edith's best friends was Bill Elwell's daughter, Doris.
Well, it was just a small town, and you knew most everybody. You'd go down the street and talk and speak, you know, to different ones that you saw. And then they had the Ward's Mesquite Grocery, and we had to run uptown. It's one block to go to the grocery store. And then they had the bank on the other corner, and, you know, all the businesses were downtown. They had a sweet shop then, too, I remember.
Edith's friends look like the kids in the Our Gang comedies. Ed Von Tobel Jr. was one. Edith's other close friend was Catherine Rose Tisdale.
Edie wanted me to come to her house and play because she usually played at my house. And I went down there and we were playing hide and go seek and just having a real good time around this furniture or boxes. And it was downstairs. And I was hiding around there and all of a sudden I raised up and I saw this man laying in this box. And I asked Edie, what is this man doing laying in the box? And then she told me. Well, I didn't know a thing about death. I hadn't had any experience of that, and it likely frightened me to death. And I would never play at her house again. And when I told my mama about it, well, then she didn't want me to go down there and play anymore either. So from then on, why, Edie had to come to my house and play. And there was usually Edie and Doris Elwell and myself.
Anna's youngest sister, Helen, died in Las Vegas at 38 in 1938. Anna adopted Helen's young son, Paul, and raised him with Edith, 2 years his senior. He took the name Paul Roberts. 2 decades later, Anna was her grandchildren's best friend.
I got to ride in her Jeep, and she always put a box in the front seat so I could see over the dashboard. And off to the desert or mountains we'd go. Anna did a lot of taxidermy work, too. So she had birds and even the buffaloes. And I remember a particularly large Gila monster in a case that I'm pretty sure she did. Tarantulas and scorpions, things like that. That's one of the creepy things I can remember is finding things in jars soaking in formaldehyde. Probably at that time, she was my favorite person in the world.
I remember going up there and playing, and we all had our little toys, and she'd give us each a drawer, and that's where we kept all of our stuff. So when we came up again, we could open our drawer and everything be in there, and had a little bank, and we'd put pennies and buffalo nickels in there. And she'd sit with us and go over the coins with magnifying glass and, you know, tell us which ones to keep and which ones we could spend.
Anna would be pleased to see the crowds of children at Clark County Museum today.
There's probably not a day goes by that we don't have a school tour out here.
More than 8,000 children visit Clark County Museum each year on school tours alone. Visits are coordinated with school curricula. Like adults, children are especially taken with the houses on Heritage Street. There they can step into the strange world of the past, where even older children fail to recognize the Edison gramophones as machines for playing music. Each year, the museum hosts touring exhibits of classic photographs of Native American life. The staff displays Native American tools from Anna's and other collections with the photographs and asks children to locate the artifacts in the photos. Anna's granddaughter remembers when her class toured the Parks Museum on 21st Street.
It was one of those days you remember always. All my friends in school were going to get to see my grandmother's museum. And we went, and they were in awe, as they should be. And of course, her snakes and Gila monsters, so that was all on display. They probably weren't too interested in the rocks. But there were deer horns hanging from the ceiling, and there was, I mean, every place you looked, every glass cabinet, every cupboard that you could open, there was stuff in it. So you can imagine a class of fourth graders, probably there were maybe 25 of us, you know, this high, running all over, looking at this stuff. And she took them along and showed them and talked about things. Because she loved it so much, you couldn't help become interested yourself. ¶¶
people of Clark County are deeply interested in their history. Today, the museum counts on them to preserve and donate the materials that document it.
There are actually a lot of items that most people would never consider donating to a museum, which they can have a lot of history. Look at your items as someone would look at them 100 years from now, because what they're trying to do to a great extent is show what life was like at certain periods in time. You know, the business climate, people's lives, and things that are really ordinary are actually very interesting.
People cleaning out attics and garages throw away our history every year.
What they don't realize is that one little piece might be insignificant to them, but by the time you put this piece with several other pieces that are insignificant, they can make a wonderful display out here at the museum.
If they have any question at all that something might be interesting to the museum, they should at least call and find out. Just a phone call.
The museum building is so small that on any given day, only small parts of Anna's and the other collections can be shown. Most artifacts are in storage. Even the popular collections on the history of gambling and entertainment can't be displayed throughout the year.
This is what our local population and visitors have been asking us to do. We simply do not have the space to do it.
The reluctance to spend public money on a local museum, which nearly kept Anna Park's collection from being shown at all, lingered in 1990 when the main facility was built.
The original design of the museum was more than they wanted to do, so they just cut it in half. And so that when they, and I think right now they're beginning to talk about expansion, they'll make a mirror image, so we eventually will have the full museum.
Clark County residents are concerned with survival and success. Spending money to preserve history has not come naturally. So Nevadans have had to think seriously about such questions as, what good is history? And why do we need a local history museum?
We need a local history museum because we don't know otherwise who we were.
Las Vegas is a town of change. Everybody tears down the old hotels, and that needs to be done, I think, because getting more tourists here all the time, making it new and different and interesting is what this town is about. But there has to be somewhere where there's a repository of all the things from the past so that people can get a good idea of where it's come from. So many people move here every month and they have no idea where Las Vegas has been. They see where it's going because it's always new and changing, but they don't know where it's been. And the museum is like the one place in town that has, from the very beginning days all the way through modern times, where the town's been, all the old houses from the town, and it's fascinating. We started out in the middle of the desert from nothing.
Whether we're talking water or land use questions, the history that's archived here will help us decide better as to the people we're going to be in the future.
I actually look at the Clark County Museum as becoming one of the really important regional museums in the western United States. The location is great, you know, with 40 plus million people here coming into Las Vegas. We're also in a process where people are just becoming cognizant of just the tremendous growth in the city and need to preserve its history. So I think this really is going to be a great museum.
The importance of one person, what one person can do, I think that's probably the greatest lesson, if people know the history of the museum, that one person can make such a difference.
I'm sure people said, what in the world are you collecting all this junk for? And it didn't matter what anybody thought. She just kept doing it.
Anna kept collecting, then Edith crusaded to get a museum established, the Henderson Chamber of Commerce established it, the Museum Guild worked to support it, and Clark County adopted it. One person, and then many people, worked to preserve Southern Nevada's history. Now, alongside the Boulder Highway, not far from the wagon wheel exit from Highway 515, sits the result, Clark County Museum.
It's where we came from, it's who we are.